Good evening. Tonight's program is on the human face, and so am I, because this is a human face that I'm standing on. The BBC has miniaturized me at enormous expense, by BBC standards, of course, so that we can take an even closer look than usual at the subject of beauty.
Hello!
And the question that we're hoping to answer tonight is, what is beauty, and is it in the eye of the beholder? So, let's start by asking some babies.
From our earliest days, we appreciate beauty. Research has shown babies spend longer looking at adults with smooth skin, big eyes, and full lips. And they don't like uglies. The fact that the tiniest babies are drawn to beautiful faces shows how much beauty matters to us human beings.
For instance, the face I'm standing on this evening belongs to Elizabeth Hurley. Good evening.
Good evening.
And obviously, we wouldn't have asked Elizabeth to do the show if she looked like this. Beauty does matter, but the odd thing is, it matters even more than we consciously realize.
You know, professionally and personally, it gets you in almost every door.
If they think you're the most stylish man or the most handsome man, then related to work, then wonderful.
It is a true fact of our society that looks are important. And anyone that doesn't believe it, nope. These women that say, I keep a clean house, he loves me. No woman's husband ever came home and said, the floor's immaculate, lie down, you hot slut. Never happens.
All the studies show that beautiful people get better jobs and earn more money. Appearances even matter when it comes to getting the top job. For example, which of these two men would you vote for? In September 1960, John Kennedy and Richard Nixon appeared on radio and television battling for the presidency.
I believe the program that Senator Kennedy advocates will have a tendency to stifle those creative energies.
I really don't need Mr. Nixon to tell me about what my responsibilities are as a citizen.
People who listened to the debate on the radio thought that Nixon had won, but people who watched it on television disagreed. Nixon's sweat and his 5 o'clock shadow put them off, and they pronounced Kennedy the winner. Nixon had refused makeup, saying it was for gays. If you have beauty, it brings many hidden advantages. But what gives it this extraordinary power? After all, Helen of Troy didn't just win the Miss Peloponnese title. She started a 9-year war. Let's start by seeing what most people think.
Well, I think beauty is in the eye of the beholder. I mean, I can think of some very beautiful actresses or models who I think are fabulous, and I can say to a boy, my God, she's gorgeous. I think I can't stand her. I hate those big lips, and she's way too thin. But I generally think she's gorgeous.
How do supermodels like Kate Moss affect you? Because the fashion industry is unanimous.
Somebody like Kate's face is incredible because her bone structure just sort of, you know, bowls you over. She has got such fabulous bone structure. So as far as a canvas for a makeup artist to make her up, and, you know, she's just so desperately photogenic as well.
Sarah Dukas is head of the Storm Model Agency. She discovered Kate Moss, and she's acknowledged as an expert at spotting the next fashionable face. She believes that ideas of beauty change all the time.
It's very fast-flowing. I mean, we find a lot of faces and they are fashionable for a moment.
Oh, wow, look at her.
We're constantly looking for new faces.
Look at that.
But it's become voracious.
It doesn't get more voracious than this. 700 entries in the competition to find a new face for the agency.
When it all started 10, 15 years ago, that faces started to look very unconventional. You know, you used to hear people say, she's hideous, or, you know, I mean, I think that girl is really quite ugly. I mean, I think, you know, the general public were probably quite aghast at some of the strange faces in magazines like The Face, for example. But I think gradually, obviously, it gets inside one, and it's what we consider is beautiful. Ooh.
Today, Sarah is face-to-face with the 10 finalists she's selected. She's looking for the next beautiful face that will work for the fashion industry.
Not too nervous, I hope.
This is Zara, aged 17. This is Samantha, aged 16. Laura, aged 18. Rachel, aged 18. So, who will they go for and why?
Eyes should be wide space. You can't have a weak jaw.
Okay.
You can't have a sort of flat nose because the light hits it and you end up sort of with a, you know, a banana.
I love the nose and the mouth. It's slightly imbalanced. It's slight. Do you know what I mean? The eyes are slightly smaller, but she's just got such an interesting...
Very nice.
Do you think she's a possible...
I'm still... thinking back to Rachel. I don't know, it's just something about her.
I know, she's serene and beautiful. Although she's terribly pretty and she's beautiful, she's got a very sort of...
There's some disagreement about who is more beautiful, Rachel or Zara.
Yeah, it's not as interesting, I would say.
Yes, it hasn't just got as much sort of depth, whereas somebody like Zara, that's got such a good structure in place, the camera just loves her face.
They've chosen Zara. Would you have? Apart from a big hooter, cross eyes or missing teeth, the widely held view in the fashion industry seems to be that beauty is what the fashion industry says it is. But I suspect there's more to beauty than that. So what can we say about this potent force in our lives? Well, here's a starting point. Look at the face I'm standing on. Now, whether you think Elizabeth Hurley is extraordinarily pretty or stunningly beautiful isn't worth arguing about, because very few people are going to maintain that she's a total dog.
Thanks, John.
Not at all, Elizabeth. And welcome to the show. Now, this gives us a clue to what scientists have been discovering.
Many scientists think that far from being simply a matter of personal taste, there are universal rules for beauty, patterns that beautiful people have in common, something that can even be measured.
Well, these five look very different to me. So the grid fits.
Facial surgeon Dr. Stephen Marquardt has spent over 25 years almost obsessively searching for the rules that govern beauty.
My job was to make faces more attractive, either that were deformed from birth or in car accidents, those kinds of things. I noticed most of the patients did look more attractive when I was done. A few looked about the same, and occasionally they wouldn't look as good. And that was very distressing, as you can imagine, particularly some of the operations were 9 hours in length, and to operate that long, and we always would fix the functional problem, but to have them not look as good was extremely disappointing.
So what would that make you feel?
It made me wonder what attractiveness was. I was doing the same thing for everyone.
Hoping to find some clues to the rules which govern beauty, Stephen Marquardt went out and asked people who worked in the beauty industry.
So I just started canvassing different people that I knew in those industries, and it was pathetic. I couldn't believe it. Nobody knew what beauty was.
Nobody
could understand it. Everybody had a different idea. Everybody had an opinion about what beauty was. And then a lot of people's opinion was it's kind of an ethereal oneness with the universe, if you will. And when they told me ethereal oneness with the universe, it's like, hey, whoa, wait a minute, I'm a surgeon. that's not going to help me out. So I kept looking.
Stephen wanted to see if people could agree on anything about beauty. So he did his own study. He got photographs of 18 very different women and then asked people from all over the world to say which they found more and less attractive.
We had people rank these 18 faces according to what they thought was most attractive to least attractive. And they found the faces up here most attractive. Then as you came down here, they found them less and less attractive until we get down in this area, when they found them barely human looking. Some of these patients were taken out of medical textbooks that were published years and years ago, and today no one would ever get this bad before they were treated. And these are all real people. They're all women between the ages of about 14 and 24 to 30. This is the entire range of human visual appearance of the faces, and we try to include everything in our study. And astoundingly, everybody in the world, within about 97%, ranked these 18 photographs exactly the same. We thought people from Asia would have a different concept, and it was very consistent all through the world. Didn't make any difference whether somebody was 4 years old or 80 years old. They ranked them the same. It was just astounding.
What this study suggests is that there are some things we can all agree on, some universal rules of beauty. So what are some of these universal factors that hold true for all beauty? Let's start by looking at babies. Ah.
Babies seem to generally be considered very attractive. So I started studying babies' faces, and I wondered if there was an ideal face for a baby, and it turned out there is. There is an archetypal face, not only for the adult, but there is one for the infant, too.
But baby's beauty is quite different from adult beauty. This baby looks wrong, doesn't he? It's because he's got an adult face on a baby's body. For some reason, the medieval artist Giotto didn't give this face a baby's proportions. Babies judged attractive tend to have plump cheeks, rosebud lips, and enormous eyes all scrunched up together in the center of the face. It's these proportions that release our protective instincts. Oh.
Yes, he's not quite what I'm looking for.
Oh, dear. Well, what about this one?
No, I don't think so.
How about this?
Sorry to be difficult, but it's not right.
Well, I don't think I have anything else. Unless this appeals to you at all.
Now that is beautiful! Oh, I love the way he dribbles. Does he hunt?
No.
Good, because I can't wait to protect him.
Oh. It's that helpless, nurture-me look that men eventually learn is what makes babies attractive. What's certainly true is that good-looking babies often stay good-looking.
Out of earshot, I could hear people, the grown-ups, saying, oh, he's very good-looking, he's just like his father, he's just like his mother.
When was that? When do you remember that?
I think I was probably 4, 5. You didn't understand it, but there was something about your look, there was something that was right about you.
Crystal's here today from Playhouse.
Look at these teenagers. The baby face features, large eyes, rounded cheeks, and full lips are still judged attractive, but a lot's changed.
They become attractive in a different way, not in a parental nurturing way, but in a sexually attractive way for a mate.
When did you realize that you were beautiful?
I realized that other people thought I was beautiful. Around 13 or 14, I started noticing that the behavior of others around me changed.
If we're talking about female beauty and standards of female attractiveness, the two largest predictors are youth and health.
Dr. David Buss studies human mating behavior.
Things like clear skin, smooth skin, full lips, because most people don't know this, lips get thinner as you age, and so full lips is a sign of youth, also a sign of health.
Stephen Marquardt suggests there may be an age range of maximum beauty.
There's a certain window during our life when we're most attractive, particularly women, and that's about between the ages of 14 and 24. Mm-hmm. That's the start menstruating at 14, they're ready to reproduce, and that correlates and coincides with their highest window of attractiveness, physically and particularly facially.
I don't think that's true at all in girls or boys, as it happens, because it's a difference of sweet, puppyish sort of prettiness when you're very young. But, you know, it doesn't really move you, I don't think. It's sweet. I think I got prettier in my late 20s, certainly, than in my early 20s. Whereas, you know, convention would have it, you look at your best when you're 17, yeah. Then go off the boil from then on.
Scientists, however, suggest that although there may be individual differences, basically, youthful features advertise sex. Sex, of course, advertises products. This is Zara, who, you'll remember, was plucked out of obscurity to be a new fashion model.
I got a letter through the post, which was harsh because I didn't know whether to open it or not. First letters I saw was, I hope you're all right. So I was like, oh, what's this going to be, you know? And it's just congratulations in big black capital letters.
Zara's now much in demand, but why? What is it about her face that people find so compelling? The scientist, Dr. Stephen Marquardt, thinks he knows.
The question's going to come up for you with people. What is attractive about you? Mm-hmm. You are attractive, and people will tell you attractive. And the reason you're attractive is you have the components of both the adult beautiful face and the baby's beautiful face, which is really interesting. It's very unusual. What it does is incorporates not only the adult beauty of the high cheekbones and the pretty nose, nice shape, and the nice forehead and nice jawline, but also the slightly retruded chin and the Cupid's bow upper lip. She has a very short upper lip like a baby, and a Cupid's bow upper lip like a baby, and the retruded chin of a baby, and the lower jaw features of an infant, which is very attractive, combined with the adult features of the high cheekbones, pretty nose, beautiful skin, and big eyes. Kind of cute. See?
Thank you. I've always thought I've had really peaky eyes, little eyes. I don't know. And big lips. I used to hate my lips when I was younger, and everyone used to call me Joker at school. Because that smile, can you see, like, I used to get picked on.
You're the smartest one, isn't that? That's nice.
So how beautiful do you consider Zara? Well, before you decide, let's hear some other theories about beauty.
Try a smile, you just did that.
Almost all scientific theories about beauty are based on so-called evolutionary psychology. The idea is that much human behavior is subconsciously driven by our animal past. For all our apparent sophistication, we are, deep down, creatures driven by a fairly basic biological urge to mate. And to have offspring. But how well does this theory explain human behavior connected with beauty? Well, looking down at Elizabeth's face makes me think of makeup.
Estee
Lauder. That's enough of that. Human beings have been using makeup for over 4,000 years, so they must have developed some inkling of what they're trying to achieve with it, what buttons they're trying to press. Even in ancient Egypt, women were already using the same techniques they do today. They enhanced their eyes with coal and used iron and copper ores to decorate their face. Dermatologist Dr. Vale Rees thinks makeup has one main purpose.
Well, makeup really tries to minimize any discoloration of the skin, any irregular contour, and then better allow attention to be drawn to certain features, such as the eyes or the lips, which we as humans want to accentuate, or at least in women at least.
You put on the base to sort of even everything out, and it's like making a flat, clean canvas, and then you start painting.
So how do we paint features and why? Well, eye makeup can make the eyes look bigger and therefore younger and sexier. Also, darkening the upper lids can produce so-called bedroom eyes.
Why do bedroom eyes exist? Why do we associate that with sexiness? It's because in the last stage of sexual encounters, a moment or two before our orgasm, one of the muscles that keeps the upper eyelid up relaxes and the eyes begin to droop. So someone who has bedroom eyes, in a sense, looks like they're always on the verge of orgasm. That is, we're
so
extending...
a permanent characteristic that reminds us of the way we look at that particular moment
just before thinking about it.
Next, lipstick. Psychologists argue that when you get aroused, your lips get fuller and redder. And that's what red lipstick is trying to mimic. When people are sexually aroused, the psychologists tell me, the lips, for example, will not only get larger, they become engorged, there's more blood in the lips, so they actually get a darker colour.
You read Desmond Morris on that, didn't you?
Yeah, some of it. No. Well, I didn't know whether all of that was right, but what I was talking about is just the fact that...
Yes. I think a lot of rubbish.
It... You think it's rubbish?
Absolute rubbish. He said that women do red lips because it's mirroring the red vulvas of chimpanzees when they're in heat.
Yeah, well, that's obvious, isn't it?
Some evolutionary biology may be bollocks, but I do believe that makeup helps advertise fertility by emphasizing youth and health. And the link between beauty and health turns out to be much closer than I'd ever imagined. Just look at those hurdlers. Ever wondered why top athletes tend to be good-looking? Professor John Manning is doing research which links looks with running ability. And he's doing it here by measuring ears.
8.02. Well, our research is concentrated on athletic ability and what the face tells us about that.
The link which ties athletic ability to beauty in Professor Manning's research is symmetry.
It's 68.77.
Whether the two sides of your face are the same or very different seems to affect your running ability.
And his left ear is 67.62. Runners with asymmetric ears run more slowly than runners with symmetric ears. And this is not a question of wind speed, and aerodynamic aspects of the face.
So what's going on here? Well, people with symmetrical bodies find it easier to run faster. And having more symmetrical ears is a sign you've got a more symmetrical body.
This is amazing when you think about it, because these asymmetries are very, very small. They're of the order of a millimeter or so. But we seem to be able to perceive them, and people rate symmetric faces as being more attractive than asymmetric faces.
Do you agree? How do you prefer me? Normal like this, or symmetrical like this? And what's the big thing about symmetry? Well, it all begins in the womb. We all start off looking like aliens, but we're programmed to grow symmetrically, so if all goes well, we turn into pretty symmetrical adults. But things can go wrong.
Now, obviously, a symmetrical face is typically a healthy face. But if you have a parasitic infection, or if you have congenital malformation of some kind that's distorted your face, it's going to produce an asymmetry. And when you detect something asymmetrical, it's no longer attractive, and you don't want to mate with it.
What neurologist Dr. Ramachandran is saying is that if you're unfortunate enough to have been infested with a parasite, such as a tapeworm, and it's residing inside you when you're growing up, then this will affect not only your bodily health, but also your face.
If you have a parasitic infection, you may not be very fertile. So for all of these reasons, it's best to avoid an asymmetrical face. And this may be one reason why you have this repulsion, so you recoil from anything that's deformed, asymmetrical, distorted.
Because it could be dangerous.
Because it could be dangerous.
In a more primitive sense, the face advertises health. Okay, any doctor will tell you one of the first things they teach you in medical school is to look at the face.
In Stephen Marquardt's study, the faces ranked good-looking were more symmetrical. The less attractive faces were less symmetrical. And the grossly asymmetric induced a feeling almost of repulsion. It's this innate reaction to faces that Hollywood has exploited.
You'll have the clear-complected individual as the hero. And then any skin defect can be used by filmmakers to identify to audiences, watch out for this one. So that skin really becomes a reflection not just of health, but of moral content.
I'm so unhappy. My stepmother and sister are going to the ball without me. I do wish I could go too.
And so you shall.
Who are you?
I'm your fairy godmother, dear. I've got a heart of gold.
I don't trust you. You're hideous.
This is facial fascism.
Poor woman.
It's true that people with bad skin are not evil. I mean, you and I both know that rationally.
Yeah.
But they have done studies to show that they would take subjects and have them interact with someone who is clear-complected or interact with someone, say, with acne scars or large scar, that there was more hesitation, there was more concern, more fear associated with the people that did not have normal skin or good skin.
Henry de Robinia has facial cancer. He knows what it's like to be stared at and judged by others. But he's very philosophical about the way he looks, and he's not upset by the honest reaction of children.
I find it extremely entertaining talking to a five-year-old about why I've only got one eye, or look slightly odd. And I've always been impressed by the simple way that the five-year-old is just interested and enjoys the conversation on the bus with a complete stranger about what it's like to have only one eye.
This is Henry at 21 when he was studying to become a barrister, and he's still working.
If I went in some absolutely extreme state, then it might be different. But certainly, having an eye removed, having the shape looking a bit odd, losing all the nerves and muscles in the left-hand side of my face, so that when I smile in a happy way, as I understand it, the right-hand side of my face moves, but the left-hand doesn't move a bit. It simply, for some reason, doesn't worry me.
Henry was 42 when he first discovered that he had a rare facial cancer. It started under his left eye and gradually progressed. Henry's proud to have a family who supported him through all his surgery.
I mean, my wife and children don't appear to pay any attention to what I look like. They don't get worried. They don't express relief that I'm not too bad. And I think that helps me as the patient enormously, because I'm not being reminded of it. I don't have people sympathizing. I don't have people saying I wish they'd done a better job. And that leaves me just being me.
Possibly the gradual change in his appearance made it slightly easier for Henry and his family to deal with. A sudden change can be traumatic in a different way. Dr. Stephen Marquardt was only 4 years old when his mother's face was badly damaged in a car accident.
My grandmother and aunt just took me in, and actually, you know, I was walking ahead of them down the hallway of my grandmother's house. My mother walked out of the bedroom she was staying in at the time, and her eyes were all bloodshot, her nose was squashed on her face, she had no upper teeth, her jaws were wired together, and her face was all cut and sutured up, and she looked like a monster. And I just about had a heart attack. I turned around, she mumbled, "Stevie, you know, hi," through her wired jaws, and I turned around and ran out of the room screaming, and I didn't trust my grandmother or my aunt or my uncles or anybody for several weeks after that. I wouldn't have anything to do with them. She wasn't my mother anymore. She didn't act the same. She didn't look the same. She didn't talk the same. It was just, and then everybody said, "This is your mother," and it was very difficult. At 4 and a half, at that point, or 5 years old, it was like, "Here's your mother back. Have a nice day." Interestingly, the surgeon who did take care of her at the time of her accident was a maxillofacial surgeon like I was. And I think that probably at some point level, maybe that's why I got into it. Life is a crazy thing. Crazy things happen. And sometimes you don't realize where you've been until you look in your rearview mirror, you know.
Stephen's childhood experience not only led him into a career as a surgeon, it also motivated his search for the rules of beauty. And he found his first clues in the writings of a Greek philosopher.
Remember Pythagoras?
The square of the hypotenuse of a right-angled triangle is equal to the sum of the squares of the other two sides.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Yes, him.
He claimed not only to quantify or to understand the secret or the code of beauty, he claimed to see it beauty in the universe. That's a pretty big statement. I'm looking for beauty in the face. He says he found it for the universe. That's pretty amazing.
What Pythagoras realized is that plants and animals grow according to fairly precise mathematical laws. It's not just chance that flowers unfold in beautiful patterns. And the Greeks found the patterns were based on a particular geometrical ratio. But it wasn't until the Renaissance that an Italian did the maths. He figured out that the key to beauty was the ratio of 1 to 1.618.
Grazie. Oh, Miss Linguini, wait.
take your glasses off. Now let your hair come tumbling down. Miss Linguini, you're beautiful. And yet, and you're not going to believe this, 1.618 actually works. Do something like measure the distance from the floor to your navel, and then from your navel to your head. If you're well proportioned, the ratio should be 1 to 1.618, and that ratio is seen all over the beautiful body.
People started noticing it. Artists noticed that the width of the mouth in a beautiful face, for example.
Yeah.
Not in any face, but it had to be beautiful. If a face was beautiful, the width of the mouth was exactly 1.618 times the width of the nose.
Really?
If the face wasn't beautiful, that wasn't the case. Dentists,
yeah,
in their dental work, noticed that the upper front tooth was 1.618 times as wide as the next tooth over, the lateral incisor.
Oh.
So the central incisor was 1.618 times the width of the lateral incisor, the next tooth over.
Wonderful. Give me some more examples.
Your fingers are each called phalanges, uh-huh, and each bone of the finger is called a phalanx. And the phalanx that's the closest to your knuckle here is 1.618 times the phalanx that's in the middle, and that's 1.618 times the length of the phalanx at the end, which is your fingernail. So that was kind of amazing. This number would come up over and over again.
Now, remember, Zara, will all this theory work on a real person like her?
This is what's called a golden divider. It divides different line areas or distances from into 1 and 1.618, which is the golden ratio. And in a beautiful face, we'll see that ordinarily the width of the mouth is 1.618 times the width of the nose. And it does in Zara, exactly.
Right.
If we look at the teeth, we can see that ordinarily, show me your teeth and smile a little bit. The width of the upper front tooth is 1.618 times the width of the tooth right next to it, and the same on the other side. The width of the upper front tooth is 1.618 times the tooth next to it. It's amazing how this proportion is repeated over and over again on a beautiful face. And the same thing with Zara, if I do the width of her mouth, I'm sorry. Oh, I'll do it again. I'm a surgeon.
Scary.
I'm used to sharp things. I hardly ever cut myself. Okay, so if I do the width of her mouth or the width of her face, the camera should be able to see that this the width of the mouth is 1.618 times the distance from the mouth to the corner of the cheek.
And it is.
Anyway, this relationship holds up over and over again in the face. Mm-hmm. And Zara's a great example. That's why she's so pretty.
So Zara's face fits the golden ratio.
It's not bad, is it?
Mm-hmm.
It's so good.
And the golden ratio, 1 to 1.618, seems to apply to all beautiful faces. Now, this idea that maths can explain a beautiful face, any beautiful face, has been taken even further by Stephen Marquardt.
So if I look at the nose is a triangle. Mm. On the front view, and on the side view, the nose is a triangle again.
Mm.
And in a beautiful face, the sides of the triangle are 1.618 times greater than the base. And from a triangle, you can build a pentagon.
What's the most attractive configuration of the face, the most attractive expression?
Smile.
Smiling.
Yeah.
When I smile,
oh,
you start to see the pentagons
here. Yes, I do. There.
Okay.
It's there.
Right, exactly.
Stephen Marquardt combined pentagons and triangles, all with the 1.618 ratio, and built a mask. He claims that the closer a face conforms to his mask, the more beautiful it is.
Let's start with, say, Kate Moss.
All right.
You know, Kate looks totally different than the others.
All right.
But if I put the mask on her, you can see that it fits very closely. The interesting thing about Kate is that her eyes are preternaturally wide or unusually wide. Her eyebrows fit beautifully, her lips, her nose, her jawline is very, very nice, even if the hairline is exactly what it should be.
And it's not just women. The same mask can be put on men. And Tom Cruise fits it perfectly. In fact, Stephen claims it fits any human face so long as it's beautiful.
Here's one of my favorite actors, star of stage, screen, and television. And let me just see how he fits. Oh, what a handsome guy.
Oh, it's Paul Newman.
It is Paul Newman. Wait a minute.
No, wait a moment.
It's better than Paul Newman. It's John Cleese.
Don't tell me that.
My
gosh. You got a moustache grid? To my surprise, it didn't fit my face at all, though Stephen had a good excuse for me.
Quite frankly, it's very masculine. You'll see the in a man,
this
the
is
eyes
very
are
kind
narrower.
Way of putting it. Well, go on. Not, the eyes are what?
The eyes are always narrower in a man, and your eyes are narrower than the grid. The lips are thinner, and you can see your lips are thinner here, and your nose is narrow just like the grid. And actually, your nose is a little shorter.
Oh, I should get a longer nose.
Which is good, actually. Fine.
Having discovered the mask, Dr. Marquardt was able to successfully use it as a template when reconstructing patients' facial deformities.
Okay, now Elizabeth Hurley, she's almost as good looking as you, but... Let's see, I think... Oh my gosh. Pretty darn close. The eyebrows are just on the upper edge of the mask, giving this nice arch. It looks beautiful.
Oh, don't tell us. So, yeah, unbearable.
It'll be our secret. The cheeks are perfect. The nose fits beautifully in there. The lips, the width of the lips is great. The lower lip has a beautiful curvature. The chin and jawline is great. It's just remarkable how it fits.
So Elizabeth's face is absolutely perfect, apparently. Personally, I think her nose is a bit pointy, but...
John!
Not you, Elizabeth. Another Elizabeth. So, that's everything that we can say about beauty that's universally true. So now we need to look at all that stuff about beauty being in the eye of the beholder. Or, in this case, the beholder being in the eye of the beauty. In other words, stuff that varies from place to place and from era to era. Yes, folks, we're entering the world of fashion. Take the fashions in skin tone. For centuries in Europe, looking pale was extremely fashionable. Elizabeth I used a mixture of white lead and vinegar to look as pale as possible. Unfortunately, it was poisonous and it had a tendency to run. Then, 400 years later, the suntan was suddenly in. Previously, it was a sign of a common type who worked outdoors with his hands. Yuck! But now a suntan meant you were wealthy enough to travel to the sun for your holidays.
The fact that so much film was made in Hollywood in the 50s and 60s had incredible influence internationally on the thought that a tanned appearance was healthy and was good and was beautiful.
So the suntan came in, and now it's beginning to go out of fashion. But is there any more to it than just fashion? Dr. Ramachandran is bravely prepared to hazard a biological explanation for preferring pale skin.
Every medical student is taught that anemia, cyanosis, which means a bluish tint of the skin, and jaundice, which means a yellowish discoloration of the skin, is much easier to detect in a fair-skinned person, especially a blonde, than in a brunette. So from a distance of 20 feet, you can say, if the blonde is anemic, because she's pale skin. Whereas a brunette can disguise this fact and fool you. So in a sense, a brunette is saying, come and mate with me, but you don't know if she's anemic or not. Whereas a blonde, there's truth in advertising. The blonde is saying, look, I'm healthy and pink. Come and spread your genes, mate with me.
So even a fashion like pale skin may have a biological underpinning. Take hair. A full head of lustrous hair is a sign of youth, vitality, and health. But the fashions in hairstyles change all the time, unpredictably. For example, in 1624, Louis XIII lost his hair and had to wear a wig. As he was king, the entire French court instantly followed the new fashion, and soon developed it beyond recognition until the wigs became so large that some of them were sublet. Between the demands of fashion and the desire to obey our biological hardwiring, the need to present ourselves as youthful, healthy, and fertile, we all spend a huge fortune every year on our beauty. But is all this fuss about beauty really justified? Well, for young people, it makes a lot of sense. Essentially, what they're looking for is pretty basic.
When you're young, you don't care about mental beauty. My mother would always try to fix me up with the girl, the lady at church's daughter, who was a great piano player. That's the last thing I wanted to
do. Made her own clothes.
Exactly, made her own clothes. Isn't that wonderful? She likes to read. Oh, great, Mom. You know, I can't wait. I was looking for a beautiful, you know, a beautiful girl who was
the
prom queen. Exactly. I didn't care if she had a brain or not. Yeah. I was just attracted to beauty, and young people are attracted to beauty.
So when you're young, looks are really important. But what happens when you grow a little older? When people are seeking a partner, a serious one, not a himbo or a bit of fluff, you know, some flibbertigibbet for a bit of fun on a Saturday night. So, what are the things that we're really looking for in a long-term partner?
My study of 37 cultures looks as about physical attractiveness as third or fourth in importance. Men, when they're doing mate selection, they look for partners who are intelligent, who are kind, who are understanding, who are dependable, who are attractive, but also who are healthy and emotionally stable. There are a large collage of characteristics that come into play in long-term mating that don't really come into play in short-term mating.
Thank you, darling. It's beautiful.
Good, good, good.
Is the other one for me too?
No, that's for my mistress.
Mistress?
Mm-hmm.
You have a mistress?
Mm-hmm.
You never told me.
It's not important.
I didn't know you had a mistress.
Oh, I see her only, every 2 weeks? You know, it's not important. It's only for sex. Just for sex.
Well, who is she? Anyone I know?
She's a showgirl. Hmm. Morris has one, too.
Your business partner has a mistress?
Mm-hmm. They're in the same show, Pasta Soap.
Can I see her?
Of course, if you're interested. Why not? Why not?
Which one is she?
Who?
Your mistress.
Oh, the brunette, third from the left.
And which is Morris's?
The blonde, the end.
Alice is better.
A man doesn't have to be good looking. A man needs personality and a big wallet. We all know this. Look at these men who marry these women. These little short, and they've got these gorgeous women, and they really think the girl likes them.
So, as we get older, we don't get quite so high on beauty. Here I am again, getting high on Elizabeth Hurley, about 5'6" high.
5'8", actually.
Oh, honestly, if I'd known she was going to be so touchy.
What?
Nothing.
John?
Later. So, if beauty gives us pleasure, how come then that it also makes people miserable?
Miserable?
Will you shut up, you old bat? Stop interrupting! Faces like hers are becoming a problem because... As I was going to say, faces like hers can be a problem if we compare our looks and then start feeling inadequate. Even attractive people sometimes find themselves doing this.
There's just posters of beautiful people everywhere. No one ugly.
Beauty used to be rare. Now it's everywhere. And that's not helpful.
In ancestral times, in small group living, a man wouldn't have encountered very many attractive women. Basically, there would have been a dozen to two dozen potential mates to start with, only a few of whom would be very attractive.
And now we're surrounded by it.
Now we're surrounded by thousands and thousands, in some cases millions, of potentially attractive partners. What that does to men is that it decreases the commitment that they feel toward their regular partner. And then they look at the models, they look at the regular mate, and they think, there's a better mate out there for me.
And even if you're lucky enough to be one of the beautiful people, there can be disadvantages. For example, if things come too easily, you may end up wondering if your looks are all there is to you.
When I was quite young, my father, he said, you know, Candy, he said, it's the beautiful women who are unhappy. it's the beautiful women who commit suicide. And I go, geez. Well, I hope I don't get to be beautiful, because that's going to be like a sort of death sentence. And he was sort of putting it, to say the least, rather dramatically, by way of saying, it's really hard if you sort of hit 45 or 50, and then you think, oh, I have no personality. I'm going to have to make it on something else now. And then it's really hard to find a personality when you're that much older, because where do you look for one? You can't sort of borrow it.
You know, I always thought that I'd be a much more talented actor if I had a broken nose and I was a foot shorter. I just thought if I had that kind of squat, burly thing going, I think I would be a lot more advanced in my technique of acting. And that's because of the shaming that goes on. Because
the what?
The shaming.
Go on.
The shaming. When you feel that shaming of maybe that you are too good looking.
And it's a little bit of a gift anyway that you can't really take credit for.
I mean, it pisses me off when they say I'm pretty.
What word would make you comfortable? Seriously.
Rugged.
Rugged?
Rugged. If I always wanted to be rugged.
Well, would you like me to punch you now,
would
love,
you please?
On television? Just settle all these problems of yours.
No.
And then you could become a seriously good actor.
I could just see this program coming out now. Fucking hell, love. I'll get my fucking black. Oh, that guy's always fucking pissed me off. You know.
Somebody once said that beauty is the passport to success, but it's not a passport, it's a visa. It expires. And if you've built your life on your beauty, what do you do when you begin to lose your looks? Well, you start thinking about plastic surgery.
What a nerve!
I had my eyes, the bags taken out from under my eyes. I had a full facelift. I had breasts lifted. And I had a face peel. And I'm looking for anything else.
Now, I don't have a tooth of my own left in my head, and I've had a couple of hair transplants. In fact, if I'd been living in 1500, I'd look like this by now. So I'm not pointing the finger at anyone who has cosmetic surgery, but I did hear one reason why maybe it's not such a great idea. It came from George Orwell, who once remarked, after the age of 40, a man is responsible for his face. In other words, if you're young, whether you're good-looking or not, it's just the luck of the draw. But as you get older, your face begins to show the world what sort of person you are, because whatever your habitual expressions are, kind, cheerful, mournful, embittered, they start etching themselves onto your face. So then, your face starts telling people what sort of a human you are. Allowing this to happen may be what people mean by the phrase, growing old gracefully. So if you're beautiful as you get older, it's not a free gift. It's because your face shows qualities that are timeless and that we all admire. Strength, kindness, dedication, wisdom, enthusiasm and humor, intelligence, compassion. Now those faces are achievements. Whereas Elizabeth Hurley's, well, very nice to look at, of course, but it doesn't mean she isn't a total shit. We'll just have to wait to see. Good night. Elizabeth!
Good night.